Continuing the road towards Como, we come to the villages of Tremezzo and Bolvedro, with frequent villas interspersed, their terrace garden climbing mountainside. In the opposite direction, towards Colico, we have the village of Cadenabbia itself, with a silk mill. But after that, the road, until we reach the town of Menaggio, is more solitary. In part, the path runs close upon the lake, with only a sort of beach intervening, sprinkled with fragments of rock and shadowed by olive trees. Menaggio is 3 miles distant. It is the largest town in our vicinity and properly our post town, though our letters are usually directed to Como, and the postman fetches them and post ours 3 times a week with great fidelity.
High mountains rise behind, their lower terraces bearing olives, vines, and Indian corn, midway clothed by chestnut woods, bare, rugged, sublime at their summits. The waters of the lake are spread before, the Villa Stadler promontory of Bellagio being immediately opposite, and further off the shores of the other branch of the lake, with the town of Varenna, sheltered by gigantic mountains. Highest among them is the Resegone, so frequently mentioned by Manzoni in the Promessi Sposi, with its summits jagged like a saw. Indeed, all these Alps are in shape more abrupt and fantastic than any I ever saw. I wish I could, by my imperfect words, bring before you not only the grander features, but every minute peculiarity, every varying hue of this matchless scene. The progress of each day brings with it its appropriate change. When I rise in the morning and look out, our own side is bathed in sunshine, and we see the opposite mountains raising their blade masses in sharp relief against the eastern sky, while dark shadows are flung by the abrupt precipices on their fair lake beneath. This very scene glows in sunshine later in the day, till at evening the shadows climb up, first darkening the banks, and slowly ascending till they leave exposed the naked summits alone, which are long gladdened by the golden radiance of the sinking sun, till the bright rays disappear, and, cold and grey, the granite peaks stand pointing to the stars, which one by one gather above.
The arrival of the steamer at noon is the event of our day. Several times acquaintances have come by it, chance visitants to the Lake of Como. When we hear the bell, my companions leave their books to run down to see the disembarkation. Today I heard one of them exclaim, "Ah, here's thee!" This announced the arrival of a fellow collegian who joined our party for 2 or 3 weeks to the great satisfaction of his mates.
The snow is gone from the mountain tops. Warm, really warm weather has commenced, and we begin to enjoy one of the most delicious pleasures of life in its way. The repose necessitated by heat during the day, the revival in the evening, the enjoyment of the cooler hours, the enchantment of the nights, to stroll beside or linger upon the divine lake, to see the sun's declining gild the mountain peaks, to watch the stars gather bright over the craggy summits, to view the vast shadows darken the water, and hear the soft tinkling bells put by the fishermen to mark the spot where the nets are set. Come with softened sound across the water. This has been our lot each evening.
Each evening, too, at dusk, the girls from the silk mill close by pass our inn on their way from work to their own village. They sing as they go and look happy. Some of them are very beautiful. They are all well conducted, I am told, keeping sharp watch on one another. The unmarried in Italy are usually of good conduct, while marriage is the prelude to fearful liberty.